Welcome to our continuing lectures on world religions. Today we're going to be talking about Islam. So far, as those of you who have been attending know, we have dealt with a number of different world religions, and by that we define them as religions that have extended beyond their origins to reach out to various parts of the world and are still extant today, or meaning still existing. Through last week, we had gone through to Christianity. Today we are going to be talking about Islam, the one that a lot of people are interested in because obviously it's in the news a lot. And then next week we will talk about sort of a mashup of several different kind of belief systems. Animism, which some would say is the oldest, it's not a world religion, but it's a belief system that underlies a number of other kinds of religious belief systems. New Age, atheism, and secularism. This afternoon at 1 o'clock we begin our 8-week course on second level apologetics, which is a response to the new atheism. So if you're interested in that, that's free of charge. In fact, we meet back there. I'm having to, as Shakespeare would say, screw my courage to the sticking place today because I lectured for 4 hours yesterday, and so I'm still flagging a little bit today, and I've got 3 more hours yet. So, but hang in there with me. Now, today is especially important, I think, because, as I said when I started this course, while I am a Christian, I'm not just a Christian, I'm a professional Christian, in that I'm the minister of this church. But my study in comparative religions and world religions, I make a particular effort, and I trust that those of you who have been coming to this have seen that, to be very fair, to be very balanced in terms of representing what the various religions believe and where their origins are, etc. But there is no case in which that is more important, perhaps, than the discussion today, which is Islam. And I say that because Islam is very little understood in the Western world and much maligned unfairly. I mean, there are problems. There are lots of problems of various kinds, not only with Islam, but with some other religions as well. But I pledge to you that we will give a fair and unbiased kind of presentation today of what Islam really believes and what it's really about. So from 2 weeks ago to last week, from the Axial Age is that period of about 100 years during which so many of the world religions began. Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism, Shinto, Jainism all began within about 100 years of each other. From there we jump forward about 500 years to Christianity. Today we jump forward another about 600 years approximately, depending upon where you mark the beginnings of the various religions, to the next great world religion, which is Islam. Islam is the second largest religion in the world. After Christianity, as you can see from this chart, there are 1.6 billion people who adhere to the Muslim faith, as it's called, and about 2.2 billion Christians. The Muslim faith is the fastest growing of all of the world religions. Now, it is fastest growing not because of conversions, but rather because the countries in which Islam is the dominant religion tend to have much higher birth rates than many other parts of the world. As we said a few weeks ago, one of the reasons why there continues to be such conflict in the Middle East, particularly Israel, the West Bank, Gaza, etc., is Israel will not, and they believe cannot, give equal vote, that is, full citizenship and rights, to people who are Muslim, because if they did so, the reason Israel was founded was to create a safe homeland, a secure place where Jews could live without being driven off or persecuted, etc. Well, the problem is that the Jewish people in the Middle East, in Israel, their birth rate is way, way lower than the birth rate of the Muslim peoples who live in that same area. There already are more Palestinian Muslims living in that area than there are Jews. And so the Jewish government and people are saying if we gave equal rights in terms of equal vote, then the nation of Israel would be voted out of existence in short order. And that's why we exist, is to have a secure place. And so you begin to see the conflict. It's a conflict that is demographic as much as anything else. It has to do with birth rates. Islam is the fastest growing of all religions because of birth rates. I also introduced you to this idea before that there today are three great families of religions. The Dharmic religions are the oldest, the ones that began in India, especially Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, Hinduism being the oldest. Then the Taoic religions are those that began further east, that is China and Japan. Taoism, Confucianism, and Shinto, along with other specialized kinds of versions of Buddhism. But the monotheistic religions of the world, and by far the largest, they constitute about two-thirds to three-quarters of all the world's religious believers, are part of the Abrahamic religions, which are the monotheistic religions of Judaism, which is very small, only 14 million, but then Christianity and Islam, the two largest. And then I keep mentioning the Iranian religions, those religions that began in what we know of as Iran or the Iranian plateau, most of which are such small populations now, they're not really considered world religions because Islam conquered those regions, and the vast majority of people who previously would have been Zoroastrian or Median or part of the Yazdanist faiths had converted to Islam. So there were some adherents to those Iranian religions, but very small. But that is sort of a separate group. But we're talking about going back to the Abrahamic religions. And like Judaism, like Christianity, we go back to one man, and that is Father Abraham, who is perceived as, he's called Father Abraham by all three of those religions, because he is seen as the world's first monotheist and the source of Judaism, of Christianity, and of Islam. I gave you this chart before. From Abraham, his first child who was born was Ishmael, who was born to his wife Sarah's handmaiden, who was Hagar. From Ishmael, there came the 12 tribes of Ishmael, who were the Arabic peoples. The Arab peoples are Semitic in the same way the Jewish people are. When you talk about anti-Semitism, most people don't realize that's usually focused just on the Jewish side of the Semitic peoples. Semitic means they are descendants of one of the three sons of Noah, who was Shem. And that includes both Jews and Arabs. Then, after having born a son by the handmaiden of Sarah, Hagar, there is a son born to Abraham and his legal wife, Sarah, who is Isaac. Isaac has two sons, one of them Jacob, his name is changed to Israel. That's where the name Israel comes from. He who struggles with God. And then Jacob, or Israel, had 12 tribes, 12 sons. Each of them founded a tribe. Those are the 12 tribes of Israel. As we said last week, from those 12 tribes, from the line of Judah, descended Jesus of Nazareth. But similarly, on the other side, from the line of the 12 tribes of Ishmael, on that side of the Abrahamic line, comes Muhammad. His tribe, the Quraysh tribe, and Muhammad himself are descended through the line of Ishmael. And it's very interesting that while they all see themselves, Christianity and Islam, all tracing back to Abraham, there are some divergent traditions. For instance, when we talk about Abraham almost sacrificing his son, God tested him to see if he really believed in him. Well, obviously the Jewish and Christian belief is that it was Isaac who was almost sacrificed. The Muslim belief is that it was Ishmael that was almost sacrificed. And so the Quran has the same stories, but different details and different interpretations. But all of these folks see themselves as descending from Abraham. This religion, Islam, began in Saudi Arabia. This is the Saudi Peninsula. The majority of it is the nation today of Saudi Arabia. And Saud is the name of a family. The family Saud, started by Ibn Saud. It's always been known as Arabia, but they added Saudi on it in the 1920s when this family took over control of the whole area. The two primary cities related to Islam are Mecca, the holy city of Islam. That is where the Hajj or the pilgrimage that is required of Muslims at least once in their life, we'll talk about that, occurs in Mecca. And you recently saw quite a number of people were killed in a stampede. Well, it's because the most they've had is in 2012, I think it was, they had in excess of 3 million people in Mecca at one time. It is every year the largest gathering of humanity anywhere on the planet. The largest gatherings ever of people have been during the Hajj or the pilgrimage each year, which occurs in 1 week. It's the last calendar month of the Islamic calendar. And so Mecca was where it started, but Medina, north of that used to be called Yathrib, that is also a critical city. It used to be called, and I'll tell you that history in a minute, it became known as the City of the Prophet and then got shortened just to the city, which is what Medina means. So Mecca and Medina are the two holy cities of the Islamic faith. I'm going to spend quite a bit of time talking about the history of Islam before I get into the what they believe, that is, the beliefs of Islam. And it's because the history of Islam is critically important to understand Islam today. People, and I've actually read this, people have said, well, you know, Christianity is very complicated because you've got Protestants and Catholics and Orthodox, and even within the different groups like Protestants, you've got Baptists and Methodists and Presbyterians. It's also complicated. Brothers and sisters, it is nowhere near as complicated as Islam. This idea that Islam is this monolithic belief system that everybody agrees with the same thing and they're all pulling on the same rope is the farthest thing imaginable from the truth. In fact, not only do they have radical differences in their beliefs, which is based upon their history and different interpretations and different events in history, but it's also true that they fight each other. I mean, imagine if the Baptists and the Methodists hated each other enough, they were always ready to go to war over this. Well, that's exactly what often happens between the Sunni, which is the largest part of the Islamic faith, and the Shia. And they live in different, you know, there's overlapping, but they have distinct areas of influence. 90% of all Muslims are Sunni. The 10% who are Shia have always felt oppressed and unfairly made the minority, and so there's always conflict. You have to know something about the history in order for that to make sense. Well, let's start with the person who started the Islamic faith, which is Muhammad. My apologies to anyone who is Islamic in the group, because showing an image of Muhammad is considered at least inappropriate. But for the sake of education, it sometimes is allowed. Muhammad, and his name means highly praised, was born in the city of Mecca around 570 AD. His parents died when he was very young. His father died earlier. His mother died when he was six. He was sort of adopted by his uncle, who put him to work in the caravan business. And so Muhammad traveled from Arabia up to Syria and back. And in the process, he met and interacted with a lot of different peoples. In that region at that time, in the 5th century of AD, as we would call it, so this is 500 years after Christianity started, he came into contact with a lot of different peoples. There were Jews that were common in that region, there were Christians, there were also a lot of pagans. And so he had exposure to these various religions. About age 25, Muhammad started going up into the mountains and spending time alone in caves in the mountains above Mecca in order to meditate and pray and just sort things out. Around that time, he also married a woman named Khadija. Khadija had employed him. She was quite a bit older, 15 years older than Muhammad, but she had hired him, and then later on they fell in love and married. Apparently it was a very happy marriage. They remained married for 24 years until Khadija's death, and he never married anyone else, even though polygamy was common in those days. Most men had multiple wives. He never remarried until after Khadija's death. Well, after many years of going up into the mountains, and let me go to this. Born in Mecca, about 610 AD, Muhammad, while he's in one of these meditative times up in the mountain, he comes back and tells his wife Khadija that either he's going insane or God has called him to be a prophet because he's having these visions. Khadija listened to him, and she became his first convert. She encouraged him that he really was being told by God, that there was a message that God wanted him to share. What had happened is that the angel Gabriel, or Jibril in Arabic, had appeared to Muhammad as he shared it with first Khadija and then others, and said, "Proclaim." And he said, "I'm not a proclaimer." And Jibril, the angel, said, "Proclaim." And finally, it's so emphatic, the angel Jibril says, "You must proclaim in the name of the Lord who created." Proclaim meant to preach this new message. So Muhammad, hearing this message, his wife Khadija encouraging him, he began to preach this message. And the message primarily was that people should convert from pagan polytheism. The belief was that God had ordained or had created the faiths of Judaism and Christianity, but the revelation of Muhammad said that both the Jews and the Christians had messed up. They had distorted their scriptures, and that their religion had become false, even though it started out right, and that this was supposed to be a corrective to that. And so Muhammad began preaching. He always insisted he was only a prophet. He was not an angel. He did not know the mind of God. He never claimed to perform miracles. He just preached what he had been told. Well, as he started preaching, it took 3 years for him to get his first 40 converts. I sort of know what that feels like. So for 40 years he preached, and he had 40 converts. But because he was preaching actively and his followers, and they were preaching, not only stop following all the pagan gods and clean up Judaism and Christianity, but also to get rid of the immorality and the materialism. Mecca was a popular, you might say, a tourist destination, partly because there was a temple there called the Kaaba, and we'll look at that, a picture of it later, it still exists, that was full of idols, and people would come to Mecca to visit this place and to worship the various idols. The cleansing of the Kaaba, getting rid of all these idols, which, again, Muslim tradition says was built by Abraham and Ishmael, his son. Some traditions say it was built by Adam and then cleaned up by Abraham, and then Muhammad came and cleaned it up again. But the idea was that you need to stop being materialistic, you need to stop being so immoral, you need to stop worshiping these pagan gods. Well, that was not in the best interest of the Meccans, who were making a lot of money out of this, or who liked the immorality. Let's face it, the reason people do stuff like that is because they like it. Well, they started persecuting Muhammad and his followers. And that, at first it was just mockery, and then they started actually taking physical action. Beating them, throwing them in jail, you know, stoning them when they were out praying and worshiping. Eventually the word came to Muhammad that there were a group of people north, 280 miles north, in what we know as the city of Medina. It originally was called Yathrib. There were a group of people in Yathrib who had heard about his message and agreed to follow him if he, being a strong leader, would come north to Yathrib and be their leader in their city, because they were having a lot of conflict between multiple tribes that lived there, and they thought, if this guy will come north and help us clean up our political problems and be the leader of our city, we'll follow his religion. Muhammad agreed to do that, and in 622 AD, by our calendar, it's year one, according to the Muslim calendar, we have the event called the Hajira, which was the escape, and it was a narrow escape, because the people in Mecca, rather than let these people go, they tried to stop them. Well, they escaped north to Yathrib, which later on, as I say, became known as the City of the Prophet, or the City Medina, and Muhammad was accepted there. He began to run the city, and the story is told that he was very successful at this. He bound the tribes together. There's different versions of that, I will say. That he bound the tribes together, and that people were astonished by this, and they considered him a great leader and considered it even miraculous. Well, eventually the people of Medina agreed to support Muhammad and his followers, and they had become followers too, in a war against Mecca. And that war went back and forth until 630. In 630, Muhammad and his followers from Medina came down, they conquered the opposition in Mecca, they took over Mecca, virtually all of Mecca converted. That may sound funny to us, but back in those days when somebody won a battle, you sort of thought, good idea that I follow their belief system now. And so Mecca converted, and there was the cleansing of the Kaaba and establishing the religion there, and then Muhammad goes back up to his center still was in Medina. The large temple of Muhammad, or the mosque of Muhammad, is still in Medina, not in Mecca. Okay? Yes?
How did they do that? There were so many people in Mecca.
Well, the city of Yathrib, or Medina, was also a large city. The people of Mecca actually outnumbered, the armies in Mecca outnumbered the people of Medina. And in fact, the first major battle that fought against them, the people, Muhammad's followers from Medina won the battle. And they considered that a sign from God. That they were, because they were outnumbered and they still won, they considered it a sign that God wanted this to happen. Later on, they had another major battle and the Medinans lost it. But that was the last time that they ever lost. After that, they succeeded in conquering the Meccans, Meccan army. But the very fact that they were outnumbered is they thought that was a sign from God when they were in their first battle there. And so in 630, they return, they defeat Mecca, they take over. In 632, Muhammad dies. And this is important because it is at this point that the historic controversy begins that leads to the major divisions in Islam and a lot of the conflict in Islam. Because when Muhammad dies, prior to his death, by the way, they had converted almost the entire Arabian Peninsula, with very few holdouts. Some of the earliest converts are in the country of Oman, which is on the southeastern part of the Arabian Peninsula, and they are very proud of the fact that they were among the early converts, even though they follow a third school of Islam called Ibadi Islam. I'll show you a map in a minute. Well, after he died, there were a series of successors that followed him. The word for successor is caliph. And these successors, one after another, for the first four at least, they launched military campaigns that ended up conquering all of North Africa, part of the Iberian Peninsula, all of the Middle East, all the way over to Pakistan and India, to the Indus River. And so the first four of those were named Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali. Now, it is at the point that the first successor, Abu Bakr, was named, that the controversies began. All of these men were related to Muhammad by marriage. Two of them were father-in-laws, two of them were son-in-laws. But the conflict started because, and I'll give you, you may not be able to read all of this, but I'll tell you what we're doing here. The big box there is Muhammad. This is Muhammad's family tree. From around the time, several generations before him and after him. The first successor to him, Abu Bakr, was his father-in-law. He was the father of one of Muhammad's daughters. Muhammad did not have any sons that survived. There would not have been any problem. He had several daughters, but he had no sons. Abu Bakr was the closest friend to Muhammad and his father-in-law. And although there was a big conflict when Muhammad died, because some of the people thought his closest blood relative, who was his cousin, who was also his son-in-law, should be the one to take over. His name was Ali. Well, the majority of people, the people who won the day, were the ones who thought, no, the person who should take over is the one who can best represent the truth of what Muhammad represented. Who's the best Muslim? That difference, the people who followed Ali, or the party of Ali in Arabic, are Shia. The people who believe that they should follow the way or tradition that Muhammad had established and get the best person for that are called the Sunnis, because they follow the way, or Sunnah. Shia, Sunni. The split started right after Muhammad died. Well, the carrier of the day, and Abu Bakr, his father-in-law, was the first. Well, when Muhammad died, vast parts of the Arabian Peninsula became apostate. In other words, they wanted to leave the Muslim faith, partly because they were forced to pay a tax. And they didn't want to do that anymore. Well, first thing Abu Bakr had to do was to take the armies that they had and reconquer the Arabian Peninsula, which he managed to do in a little over a year. And they all were brought back into faith. As he approached death, Abu Bakr identified the second caliph or successor, a man named Umar, which also was a father-in-law, was father-in-law of Muhammad. He was married to one of Muhammad's wives, because after Khadijah died, he had a number of wives. So Umar comes along. Umar becomes the next caliph, and Umar is successful in doing several important things. He set up the political structure that Islam would use in the areas they conquered. Both Abu Bakr and Umar extended Islam by military campaign. They conquered various areas, into North Africa, north through the Levant, which is Israel-Syria, up into what had been Persia, into part of what had been the Byzantine Christian Empire. I'll show you some maps here. But so Umar was primarily responsible for beginning to expand and establishing the political structure. How are they going to run things? He also established the Islamic calendar. Year one of the Islamic calendar is the year of the Hajira, the great pilgrimage or the travel that Muhammad and his followers did north from Mecca to Medina in order to establish that there, the Hajira, that's what that's called. That's year one of the Islamic calendar. And so everything is oriented around that. That is considered the date in which Islam really began. As Umar was ill and almost at death, he appoints a committee of six men to decide who the next caliph will be. Well, that committee decided that there were two candidates, Uthman and Ali. Remember, Ali is the cousin and son-in-law. Well, Uthman, another son-in-law, is selected by that committee. And all this time, through these first three caliphs, everybody else
the people who supported Ali are getting very disappointed about this. So Uthman comes along. Uthman is most famous for formalizing the Quran, the written Quran. And if you go to a Muslim country today, if you visit a mosque, because they have tours and things, you're not welcome into a Muslim service. I've had people on the trips we've taken into the Middle East, and they go, well, why don't we go to a mosque? You know, we can at least listen to the singing, and even if we don't speak Arabic and things like that. Well, they don't do any singing, and you're not welcome if you're not Muslim, because it is a Muslim worship. Okay, they are acknowledging Allah, and if you're not one of the people who will do that, then you're not supposed to go there. We had other people who said, well, we're here in the Red Sea, why don't we just pull the boat over and go visit Mecca? You can't go to Mecca if you're not Muslim. It's not allowed. Okay? If you tried, it would be very unpleasant circumstances for you. So, anyway, the establishing it, but if you go there, that's what I was going to say, if you ever visit a mosque, the imams or the tour guide or whatever, they always have copies of the Quran there, and they'll pull up a copy of the Quran and they say, this book is exactly what was recited and written down by Muhammad. Muhammad was illiterate. He didn't write the Quran down. He recited it to his friends, which is what Quran means. It means recitation. And they wrote it down. And the third of the caliphs is the one that wrote it down finally and gave the final form to it. So they will always hold it up and say, unlike the Christian Bible or any other religious books, this has never been edited or changed in any way. And so therefore, this is God's word. And they're very critical of any other religious writings which they say has been perverted. Remember, they thought that Judaism and Christianity had started out right, but then distorted it, got it wrong. Interestingly, too, someone came up and showed me they had a two-volume copy of the Quran. Well, on the left-hand column of what you showed me, it is in English. On the right-hand side, it's in Arabic. A Muslim, a true Muslim, committed Muslim, would say that's not really the Quran, because the Quran was given in Arabic. Arabic is considered the language of God. They believe that the Quran has existed throughout all eternity in the Arabic language. Arabic is the language God speaks, and so whenever the Quran is translated into another language, that's considered only a commentary on the Quran. It's not considered the true Quran. That's how strongly they feel about that. So, the third of the caliphs, the successors, Uthman comes along. He reigns for 12 years, and when he dies, finally they let Ali take over. Ali, who is the cousin and son-in-law, and so finally the Shia, the party of Ali, feel like it's finally worked out the way it should have. Ali actually was not a caliph for very long. He did two things. He moved the capital from Arabia up to the north, to Kufa, a city in modern-day Iraq. And he fired a bunch of the sort of regional governors and administrators that had been with Uthman. And so, right away, he's unpopular. So unpopular, in fact, because Uthman, the predecessor to Ali, the third caliph, was assassinated. A lot of people thought that Ali should be aggressive in trying to capture and execute the assassins. Ali didn't seem to be too concerned about that. So one of Muhammad's wives, Aisha, got her own army together and marched north. They took the city of Basra and found 4,000 people there they thought were part of the campaign or the effort to assassinate Uthman, and they executed him. Well, Ali saw this as a competition to his leadership, and so he brings his army out. You've got the army of Aisha, the wife of Muhammad, one of the wives, and the army of Ali, the successor to Muhammad, and there's a kind of a standoff. The belief is that neither one of them wanted to fight a war, but in the middle of the night, the two parties started fighting. It's called the Battle of the Camel, and it was the first Muslim civil war. There were three later on. Ali was successful in that, but they continued to challenge his authority. The people who didn't think he was a good leader, the people who were not part of the party of Ali, and eventually, he is assassinated as well. Now, there's Ali married to the favorite daughter, Fatima, of Muhammad. So those four red circles are the four caliphs. They are called the Rashidun caliphs, which means the rightly guided caliphs. Pretty much everybody thinks they had it right. And it's at that point, they completely disagree after that. This is the area that were conquered during the reigns of the Rashidun Caliphs from 632 to 661, from the death of Muhammad to the end of the Rashidun Caliphate, under Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali. When Ali, late in Ali's life, after the whole thing with Aisha and the first Muslim civil war, a relative of Uthman's comes up, Muija was his name, and he starts challenging Ali. They start fighting. Eventually, Ali is assassinated, and at that point, Muawiyah takes over. Muawiyah, my Arabic is not very good, sorry. And he institutes the second caliphate, the first one after the Rashidun's, which is called the Umayyad Caliphate. He introduces the Umayyad culture, which it spreads widely. He moves the capital city to Damascus, because he was from Syria. He was the governor of Syria under his relative Uthman. So Damascus becomes the capital city, and they expand. He is militarily very gifted. He expands the Umayyad Caliphate to 5.17 million square miles. It becomes, at that time, the largest empire the world had ever seen, and even today, it's the fifth largest empire that the world had ever seen. After the Umayyad Caliphate, they were weakened by additional Muslim civil wars. There then is a caliphate called the Abbasids that succeeded them, then a caliphate called the Fatimid Caliphate. This is the descendants of Fatima, the favorite daughter of Muhammad, and the wife of Ali. Other than when Ali briefly was actually the caliph, and then during the Fatima Caliphate, which overlaps because they controlled part of the Muslim world, and other caliphs, proclaimed caliphs, controlled other parts. This is the only time that Shia has ever had any authority. They've always been a minority. And you might say that modern day Iran may have authority. But this is the extent of the world, the Arab world, I'm sorry, the Islamic world under the Umayyads. Remember I told you Muawiyah was very successful militarily. You will notice that this goes all the way up into Spain and up into southern France. This is the time when they actually went into France, and it was Charles Martel, the grandfather of Charlemagne, Charles the Great, who eventually, at the Battle of Tours, they were right out, you know, they were very near Paris, the Muslim armies. They pushed them back, but they continued to remain in Spain, what we know of as Spain, the Iberian Peninsula, for many, many years, many generations after that. How many of you all have been to southern Spain? If you've been to, okay, then you've seen the Alhambra and some of the other, this was called the Cordoban Caliphate. Okay, when after they got cut off from the rest of the Arab world, they continued to have a caliphate. They continued to rule in that part of the world. So this was the Umayyad Caliphate. This map shows you the dark orange are the areas that were conquered under while Muhammad was still alive. And you will notice on the right-hand side, this little orange part over here, that's part of Oman. It's part of the United Arab Emirates in Oman. And as I say, Oman has always been very proud. Oman's a fascinating country, if you ever have a chance to visit. And quite open. They have some beautiful cities there. The orange part are the parts that were conquered under the Rashidun, the first four caliphs after Muhammad. And then this lighter green part are the parts that were conquered under the Umayyads. They got pushed back eventually out of the Iberian Peninsula and the Maghreb, which is the furthest northwestern part of Africa, under the Abbasids. And then the Fatimid Caliphate. Again, this is Fatima, circled right here, the wife of Ali, the favorite daughter of Muhammad. And the Fatimid Caliphate, under her descendants, direct descendants, which is the only Shia caliphate that ever has existed other than Ali himself for a few years, they conquered all of North Africa. They had their center in Egypt. In fact, they built Cairo. They built the city of Cairo. So they control the Middle East and North Africa, other parts of the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, the part of the Persian Empire, etc. They were controlled at the same time by other Muslim rulers. And then the Ayyubid dynasty. You'll notice it's not a caliphate. How many of you all have ever heard of Saladin? Saladin from the Crusades, you know, the guy who he and Richard the Lionheart were big competitors in the Crusades. If anybody came to my Crusades lecture, you know all about this. Well, Saladin was the vizier, or sort of the, you know, the chief administrator and counselor in the Fatimid dynasty. But he felt like they got weak and were not leading well, and so he took over. He did not claim to be the caliph. He was not descended from the, any of the tribes related to Muhammad. So he did not profess to be the caliph. The caliph's successor is the religious leader. But he did make himself the ruler and created the dynasty, the Ayyubid dynasty, and continued to control. This is during the time of the Crusades. It was Saladin that succeeded in taking Jerusalem back from the Western Crusaders. And Saladin ruled for many years, and then a phenomenon called the Seljuk Turks. The Turks, you know the expression Turk, do you know why they're called Turks? Because they come from Turkmenistan, one of the stands. The Turkmenistanis were considered great warriors, and so various of the governors, the Muslim governors, they converted to Islam. The Muslim governors in the areas we know of as Iraq and Persia hired them as mercenary warriors. But as happened with Saladin, after a while they thought, why am I listening to these guys? We're smarter and stronger than them. So they took over and they won several battles. They eventually ended up taking over all of the area you see here from the descendants of Saladin and the Ayyubid dynasty. And you'll notice, this is what we know of as Turkey. What was known as Asia Minor in ancient times, they ended up conquering, continuing to move further west and further west and further west, and conquered almost all of the Asia Minor, almost all of modern-day Turkey. Now, that is why they threatened Constantinople. The city of Constantinople, which today we know as Istanbul, prior to that, the Constantinople is called Byzantium, it was the capital of the Christian Byzantine Empire. It's right there. The reason why the Crusades happened is because the Seljuk Turks had conquered and gotten right to the gates of Constantinople and were threatening to take over the capital of the Byzantine or Greek Christian Empire. And the Byzantine emperor sent word back to Rome and said, help! We need your help. We're about to be overrun by the Seljuk Turks. Eventually, they were successful at that. Well, the Seljuk Turkish rule turned into the Ottoman Empire. Because one of those Seljuk Turks, one of those Turks, was named Osman. Osman got turned into Ottoman. I don't know how to do that. It's changed letters like that, but it happens all the time. Like, the descendants of Shem are called Semites. What happened here? I don't know. So the Ottoman Empire, and the Ottoman Empire existed from 1400 until the end of the First World War. So for a period of almost 500 years, it was one of the major world powers. And it was a Muslim. In fact, this map gives you an idea that for a period of almost 100 years, the Muslim armies of the Ottoman Empire were right outside the gates of Vienna. That's Vienna, Austria. The Ottoman Empire conquered all of Greece, all of Eastern Europe, this is Vienna here, all the way right up to the gates of Vienna. And much of the energy of Western Europe was spent trying to defend against the Muslim armies that had conquered most of Eastern Europe. In fact, it's an interesting thing for us Protestants that one of the reasons Protestantism was allowed to survive is the Holy Roman Emperor, who was Charles V at that point, every time Charles V was getting ready to try to crush, because he was Catholic, to crush these Protestants, he would find out that the Muslims had made a new assault on Vienna or some other major city that was part of Europe, and instead of having to go after the Protestants, he'd have to send his armies to go after the Muslims. And Protestantism might not have made it, had it not been for that reality. But you see, this is all of Eastern Europe was taken by the Ottoman Empire. This is under Suleiman the Magnificent. If you go to Istanbul today, you can go to the Mosque of Suleiman the Magnificent. It's up on a hill, and not a lot of people go there, but it's really worth going to. It's quite spectacular. So, the Ottoman Empire continued, at its height in the 1500s, in the 1600s, Europe got together in what's called the Holy League, and there was the War of the Holy League, where a number of Christian nations in Europe got together and successfully fought against the Ottomans, the Ottoman Muslims. And they pushed them back and pushed them back, and one country after another gained their independence, countries like Serbia, Greece, etc. So the lighter brown This is the map we looked at before, up here, etc. This is within 100 years of the map I showed you. But over the next period of time, by the start of the First World War, all of Eastern Europe had been taken back. They were pushed back to Asia Minor, Anatolia, it was called, what we call Turkey, as well as the Middle East, part of Saudi Arabia. Well, Turkey, or the Turkish Empire, the Ottoman Empire, made the very bad choice in the First World War of siding with what was called the Central Powers, which were Germany, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and they ended up losing. They lost the war. After the war, the Allied forces came in and divided up the Ottoman Empire. And that was the last time. In fact, when they divided up the Ottoman Empire in 1922, after the First World War, the Allies marched into Syria and marched into other areas and would not allow self-rule. In fact, they threw out kings who had been elected by the people, the French especially. And so at that point, the Ottoman Empire was completely broken up, and the Allies threatened to march in. In fact, they began to march into what we know of as Turkey. Well, one man, whose name was Mustafa Kemal Pasha, later to be called Mustafa Kemal Atatürk. Atatürk means the father of the Turks. He organized the armies. He couldn't defend Constantinople because it was right on the end. Constantinople bridges between Europe and Asia. He couldn't defend Constantinople, so he moved the capital city to, yes, Ankara. That's why Ankara is still the capital of Turkey. And he defended, he fought battles, and he was ready to go to all-out war. And finally the Allies said, okay, we just got off a big war, this was not worth it. And Atatürk reorganized Turkey. He got rid of the caliphate, he got rid of the sultan. The last sultan was in 1923, and they established the Republic of Turkey. And Atatürk understood that if he's going to make it in the world, he had to become more modern. They had to be able to relate to the side that won. And so he had the clothing change, he changed the alphabet so that it could be transliterated from the languages of Europe. Everything about that country. One man really rebuilt that country. And Turkey today is one of the most successful countries in the world. They're having a lot of trouble right now on their southern border with all the Syria problems and ISIS and all that. But they are still a Muslim country. It is 98% Islamic, but it is a secular Islamic state. They have their version of separation of church and state so that it is not Islamic in the way that you think of a lot of countries. Okay, that's the history. And the biggest part of that is recognizing that right after Muhammad's death, there was a huge difference in terms of what direction they should go. And that started the big rift that still exists today between the majority Sunnis and the minority Shia. This is what Islam looks like today. Remember I told you it was more complicated? That it's not this monolithic faith that's, you know, trying to take over the world? The left-hand side here, the orange, is Sunni. Now that amounts to 90% of the Islamic people. Sunni is one body, but they've got five different schools that exist. The Hanafi, Hanbali, Maliki, the Barlevi, and the Shafi'i. Each of them interprets things differently. Think Baptists say you have to be dunked, Methodists say you can be sprinkled. You know, it's a little bit more than that, but similar to that. But fundamentally, they agree. The green, much more complicated, even though it's only 10% of the Muslims in the world, is Shia. The Shia faith is actually split up into a lot of different pieces who really don't get along with each other. Right? There are other differences. For instance, the Sunni believe that Muhammad did not designate a successor. The Shia believe he did, that it was his cousin and son-in-law, Ali, and so the descendants of Ali are held in higher regard. The Sunni, their leaders are imams, and they're thought to be fallible humans. You know, they're respected and revered, but they're human leaders. Shia believes that the Mujtahids are divinely ordained rulers who cannot be defied. They speak with the authority of Allah. Think Ayatollah Khomeini, okay? Absolute authority. Those are some of the differences. Now, within Shia, because it's more complicated, there are a lot of different groups. I want you to memorize this chart. The thing I want you to see here is all of them agree with the earliest caliphs, the earliest ones who followed after Muhammad. But then they disagree, and if you follow these lines, this is Muhammad right here, you get groups that believe that after Muhammad's son, Hussein, there was only one other legitimate caliph, and then we get to today. And so they don't have any caliphs in modern times. But the most common of these, there's a group that believes that there were five legitimate successors to Muhammad. They are called Fivers or Zaydis because they believe the last legitimate successor was Zayd. You then get the largest of all the Shias are called Twelvers because they have 12 descendants or caliphs, successors rather, not descendants, 12 successors to Muhammad. They are the largest group of the Shia. And to be quite honest, they're also the scariest because they, the last of the Shia Twelver imams or caliphs was called Muhammad al-Mahdi. They're sometimes called Mahdists because they believe that Mahdi, the last legitimate successor, the reason they haven't had any others is they believe that in 1873 he disappeared from view. It's called the occultation, but he's still around. And it's only a matter of time for him until he reappears and will demand obedience. And so the Twelvers, the largest part of Shia, have a very kind of mysterious, and they believe that if they need to commit acts of war in order to hasten the coming of the Mahdi, to make his presence visible and known again, then they're prepared to do that. There are others, the Seveners are called Ismailis. There are Naziris. How many of you all ever heard of the Aga Khan? Heard the name Aga Khan? He is an English businessman known for liking really fast cars and racehorses. He raises horses. He's a billionaire. He is the religious head of the Naziri sect of Shia. The furthest thing imaginable from some, you know, long-bearded imam, you know, who lives relative poverty somewhere, like some other Shias. But they believe the Aga Khan is the spiritual leader. The fact that he's a billionaire who really likes fast cars. This is what the map looks like in terms of Islam today. The green areas, you will notice by far the most, are Sunni Islam. That's where Sunni dominates. That doesn't mean there aren't some Shias there, but it's by far the dominant area. The orange, which is primarily that is Iran and some of the areas, part of Iraq and some other areas around it, but the center of modern-day Shia in terms of political influence is in Iran. One of the things that we kept running into in the news is why are the Iranians and the Saudis involved in Yemen? Well, it's because there is a majority of Sunnis, which Saudi Arabia is Sunni, that are in Yemen on the south end of the Arabian Peninsula, but there is a fairly large population of Shia. The Shia have rebelled against the Sunni government, actually chased the president out of the country, and they created a civil war within Yemen. Well, Saudi Arabia is trying to defend the Sunni side and the Sunni president that they want to reinstate because they don't want Shia influence that close to them. It's immediately on their southern border. Iran has gotten involved because they want to defend the Shias who were there, and they want them to succeed in their rebellion so that they will extend their influence, so that the orange part of the map gets bigger. All right? And there is, you'll notice over here there's three categories. This purple right here, that's the country of Oman. Oman, again, there are people living in other places, but Oman is the only place where the predominant religious belief is Ibadi, which is sort of a third family. All right, that's the history and the differences, etc. Let's talk about the basic beliefs of the faith. The basic beliefs, Islam means submission, and so basic beliefs of Islam is submission to Allah and His will. A Muslim is a person who submits to Allah, and they are part of the Islamic faith. Muslim life is more about orthopraxy than orthodoxy. I've talked about that in some of the other religions. Orthopraxy is right practice. Orthodoxy is right belief. Christianity, the most popular verse in the Christian Bible, is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Christianity is an orthodox religion. It's about what you believe. You still have responsibilities on how you act too, but it's primarily about belief. Islam is about how you act more so. It is based on the writings of the Quran, which in Arabic means recitation. Also, lesser but still important are the Sunnah, which are the life examples of Muhammad and his first followers, and the Hadith, the sayings of Muhammad and his companions. And the revelation, as I said, to Muhammad was in Arabic. That's considered the holy language. Anytime the Quran is translated into another language, it's not considered the real Quran. It's a commentary on the Quran. Now, Quran, recitation, the sacred text, the highest authorities in all religious and legal matters. They believe it is a flawless reproduction or record of the revelation that the angel Gabriel, or Jibril, gave to Muhammad before his death in 632. And a perfect copy of what has always eternally existed in heaven. That God gave this to Muhammad, but the original Quran is heavenly, it's always been there. The Quran is divided into 114 surahs, or chapters. Each of them is broken up into ayat, or verses. To give you an idea, the Quran is about the same length as the Christian New Testament. And like the Christian New Testament, it's not arranged in chronological order. The Christian New Testament is arranged in sort of big categories, but then in length, like the letters of Paul, there are 13 letters of Paul. They're not in chronological order, they're in order of size. Romans is first because it's the longest. Philemon is last because it's the shortest. Then it goes down. The same thing is true with the Quran, other than the first one, which is kind of an introduction. Each of the surahs, or chapters, are from the longest to the shortest. The shortest ones are actually the earliest ones, and so if you want to read it in roughly chronological order, you can almost read it backwards. And get a chronology. But it is considered the Word of God. It is written in first person plural because it is seen as being God speaking. Anytime it is Muhammad speaking, it will start out with say and then the message. Because it's a way of saying that Allah told Muhammad to say this, that it's Muhammad speaking, other than God speaking directly. Right? Now, that's the Quran. That's most important, but also important are the Hadith and the Sunnah. The Hadith, or the narrative or report, are a record of the words and deeds of the Prophet and of his most immediate followers and family. It is not regarded as much authoritative as the Quran, but it is still an important source of doctrine, law, and practice. If you know Judaism, Judaism sees the Tanakh, the old, what we call the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, as being of ultimate authority, and actually the first five books, books of Moses, as most authority. But then they have other commentaries on it that have come down through the, you know, the centuries. And those commentaries are highly valued, but they're not seen as equal to the Hebrew Bible. Same thing is true, it's comparable in Islam. The Quran is first, but the Hadith is very important. And you notice that Muslim countries around the world will have very different approaches to the law. Turkey, 98% Islamic. The way they interpret Muslim law is very different than the way they interpret in, let's say, Iraq, or let's say, under the Taliban. How is that? If they got the same holy book, the same Quran? Well, because they interpret the Hadith very differently. Because the Hadith is more the source of Sharia law, the Islamic law, than the Quran even. Because it's an interpretation based upon the life of Muhammad and his followers. Shia, which is the Iran, for instance, the Ayatollahs, etc., they have a number of different hadith that they consider authoritative that the Sunnis don't have. So they're working from different documents in some cases. They'll have some in common, but they have some that are different. And so they get very different interpretations. The hadith is looked to for great guidance because the Quran itself says that you should follow the example of Muhammad. Now, the interesting thing is, they're less concerned in the Hadith with whether or not this actually would be something Muhammad would say than they are with, is there a credible list of resources? Every Hadith has both content and it's also got the sources. And they have a system of evaluating the Hadith based upon how reliable they think it is back in the source. For instance, the most reliable, the strongest, are where it says, the Prophet said, meaning Muhammad said it himself. And the next level would be, the Prophet said to one of his companions. And then the Prophet said to one of his companions who told us. And so different levels of authority on this stuff. And so you get different interpretations. Then the Sunnah, which means the clear, well-trodden path, it's the same word that Sunni Islam names itself after, is a commentary that gives the ideal way of life for Muslims based upon the teaching and practices of Muhammad. It's commentary that says, this is how Muhammad treated his wives. This is how he treated his children. You should do that too. It's all based upon interpretations of the Quran, but it has to do with, here's the example we have. Not the words of, again, the Quran is the word of God. The Hadith are the words of Muhammad and his early followers. The Sunnah is a commentary that says, based on that stuff, how should you act? And Muhammad's words, his habits, his practices, the things he approved of or disapproved of are considered very, very important in Islam, and that's recorded in the Sunnah. The six articles of faith of Islam. First, there is one God. The only unforgivable sin, absolutely, in Islam is the sin of shirk, which means to put anything equal to God. And out of fear that they might do that, that's why human beings, the highest example of God's creation, are not allowed to be represented in Islam, because you might be competing with God. You might be, if you try to reproduce God's greatest creation, even if it's in a two-dimensional piece of art, you need to never feel like you're competing with God, and so you cannot do that. Second, there's a belief in the angels of God. Angels are God's creatures made from light who do His will. They do not have free will of their own, unlike angels according to Judaism and Christianity. Angels always have to do God's will. There's another kind of spiritual being God created called the jinn. Jinn is where we get our word genie. And that, why is it that's always in the desert? Because they come from Arabia, this idea. The jinn are creatures of free will. Sometimes they do good, sometimes they do evil. They're the ones that tempt. But there is no such thing as a fallen angel in Islamic belief. There is a belief in the prophets and messengers of God, especially Muhammad. Islam recognizes all of the Old Testament and then Jesus, all of them as being prophets of God. Abraham, Moses, David, Ishmael, Isaiah, all of them are considered prophets of God. But Muhammad is the last of the prophets, the seal of the prophets. There have been none since him. But they recognize him all. They believe Jesus was a prophet of God. They believe he was born of the Virgin Mary. That's in the Quran. But they don't believe he was God, because that would be doing something equal to God, Allah. You can't do that. So they don't believe in the divinity of Jesus. They just believe he was a great prophet. There is a belief in the books of God, especially the Quran. But they also include the writings that were given to Abraham, the scrolls of Abraham, which they say were destroyed, don't exist anymore. The Gospels given to Jesus, they believe, are holy books. They believe in the Psalms given to King David. They believe in the Torah given through Moses. All of them are holy books, but none of them equal to the Quran, which is the book that was in heaven from all eternity. They believe in a day of judgment and an afterlife, where those who are true followers of God will be given heaven. Those who have denied God, who are not Muslim, that is, they are not submissive to God, will be cast into eternal fire. Remember that these monotheistic religions all come from some of the same roots. And they believe in the supremacy of God's will and divine decree, that divine decree. This is sort of what Christians talk about as predestination. God alone can know who's saved, who isn't. God's will is eternal, unquestionable, and will be done. Okay? These are the basic beliefs, the six articles of faith. And then the other part of it that you've heard of are the five pillars of Islam. First is the Shahada, or the declaration of faith. All that is required to be a Muslim is to make the declaration of faith in proper Arabic, and to mean it, and to believe it, and to do it in the presence of witnesses. The Shahada, translated, is there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. Now the translation varies. In Arabic, it's La ilaha illa Allah wa Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. Okay? That is the start. Second, we have the prayer. You're all aware of the five times daily where Muslims will kneel and pray at dawn, at midday, in the afternoon, at sunset, and evening. This is required. Now, there are, in almost all of these, the Shahada, but in several of these, there are allowances made. If you're traveling, or if you're doing a job that doesn't allow you to stop, or if you're sick, then you're allowed not to do this. You can make it up later. Right? You can do twice as much next time you pray and make it up. But you are expected to pray. They always pray facing in the direction of Mecca, which is called the Qibla, the direction of Mecca. direction of Mecca. In fact, if you ever go into a Muslim mosque, in the wall there will be a niche carved out. That niche tells the people, this is the direction of Mecca. In fact, interestingly enough, if you ever go to St. Catherine's Monastery in the Sinai Peninsula, that area being controlled by Muslims, they built a mosque inside the walls of the monastery. There's a mosque there, but it has never been used for worship because when they built it, they got the direction wrong. And so the Qibla that's indicated by the niche in that mosque is pointed the wrong direction, and so it has never been used for services. This is very important to them. Prior to doing the prayers, there was a time of ablution where you wash in a certain pattern with water. If you were, given that this is a desert religion, it started there, if you don't have any water, you can use sand. But you have to go through this cleansing ablution before you pray. And by the way, the noonday on Friday, noon prayer on Friday is considered the most important. That's you should gather, but you can pray by yourself otherwise. And women especially are allowed to pray in their home, right, if they wish, rather than go to mosque. If they go to mosque, men and women are separated. And then you go through a pattern of kneeling. There's certain words that you say at each point in it. There are some slight differences between like Ibadi, Shia, and Sunni. Slight differences, but they're basically the same. The third requirement or pillar is almsgiving or zakat. Muslims, proper Muslims, if they can afford it, meaning if they're not going to deprive their family, they have to still feed their family. But apart from that, you are expected each year to give the equivalent of 2.5% the value of your property, not of your income, not of what you made this year, but of the total value of your property. Now, you don't have to give it to the mosque. You can give it to a relative who is in need. You can give it as a charitable gift to someone or an organization or whatever. But you do have to give it as a charitable act. There are, within Shia, there's an additional 1/5 tax. One-fifth of the percent of your total wealth that is given to pay for the hidden imam, the Mahdi, and for the people who follow him. So you are expected. There are additional offerings that are also strongly recommended in the Quran, but the 2.5% is required every year, the zakat. The fourth is the sa'um, or the fasting during the holy month of Ramadan, which we have just completed. The fasting from daybreak until sunset, you are not allowed to eat, you are not allowed to drink, you can't smoke, you can't chew chewing gum. It is strongly recommended that you not curse or get mad at anybody or say harsh words. This is for a 1 month period. You are expected to focus on God and to deny yourself in recognition of God's authority. And because it's from sunrise to sunset, there's some very interesting things that happen there. How many of you all have been to Dubai? Tallest building in the world is in Dubai, the Burj Khalifa, and it's a mile high. Well, the people who live high up in the Burj Khalifa, sunrise and sunset occurs for them at a considerably different time than the people who are at the bottom. And so they have had to have imams come up with a separate set of rules for when do they start and when do they finish the fasting time during Ramadan. The fifth is the pilgrimage to Mecca, or the Hajj, which occurs every year for 1 week in the last month of the Islamic calendar. And obviously it just happened because you heard about the stampede. What happened there is one of the things they do during that week is they will go to the city of Mina, which is nearby, within walking distance, although it's a few miles, from Mecca. And there are stone pillars out there. And as a symbolic fight against the devil, they throw stones at these pillars. The pillars represent Satan. And they do that. Well, you've got 2 million people going out and coming back. Somehow, somebody got scared, something happened, and a stampede started. It had nothing to do with still throwing the rocks. That was just that part of the Hajj. And so people started stampeding, and they crushed several hundred people to death. There was also a crane that fell just at the start of Hajj in Mecca, and some people, a number of people were killed. Anytime you get 2 million people together, things like that are going to happen. There have been people who were crushed to death at a University of Wisconsin football game, a number of years ago. So it can happen. My wife's from Wisconsin, so I know these things. So the Hajj, once in their life, if they can afford it, if you are not going to deprive your family while you do this, then you're expected to go for this pilgrimage to Mecca. You can go at other times of the year than this 1 week of Hajj, but that's considered a lesser pilgrimage. And when they go to that, there are... I'll show you something here. This is all five of the pillars. There are the Shia Islam, the Ismaili branch of Shia Islam, adds two more. The Walaya, which is guardianship of the faith, which some of the Shia use that as the reason why they would fight battles to defend the Shia faith. And also the Tahara, or purity, the cleanliness of soul, the clothing of surrounding. This is what Mecca, the primary mosque in Mecca, looks like during the Hajj. 2 million plus people, and in 2011, 2012, there are over 3 million. But because of difficulty in travel and violence in the region, additional costs, fewer people have gone. This is the Kaaba. This is, it's a black stone, but they cover it with fabric, with gold thread in it. This is open, and inside, it's considered a small temple. In one corner of it is a rock, which was a meteorite. What happens during the Hajj is the people who gather in this courtyard around the Kaaba, they will circle the Kaaba 7 times counterclockwise. And originally the instructions were you should touch this stone. Well, get 2 million people there, they're not all going to get to touch the stone. So what you will see if you see the video is people will be walking around. If they can't get close enough to touch it, they will just point at it as they walk around. So this sort of diagram gives you an idea with the Kaaba in the center. The Tawaf is the 7 times walking around. After the 7 times walking around, they will drink from the Zamzam well. The Maqam Ibrahim here are the footsteps of Abraham are seen to be stone there, and it's covered, you can see them. And then they go out to symbolize Hagar's effort to try to find water when she and her son Ishmael were out in the desert, and she's running around trying to find water, and then God causes a spring to break forth. There are two hills very near the mosque, the hill of Marwa and of Safa, and the people will go back and forth between these two hills, symbolic of Hagar's search for water. It used to be there were just two hills and they were outside. Now this is all covered. They have lane markers in the middle. They've got a lane for people with disabilities so that you're not being run over by everybody else. And so there are several things. Okay, I'm going to take 2 more minutes. I'm 8 minutes over. I'm going to take 2 more minutes and talk about the rise of political Islam. Political Islam, or Islamism, as it's sometimes called. Anytime you put an ism on the end of it, scientism, rationalism, it means going too far with something. Islamism is a set of ideologies that hold that Islam should not only guide your personal life, but it should be the rule that guides social and political life as well. This movement actually began in 1928 with the creation of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, and since then has taken on many, many different kind of permutations. The Al-Qaeda, modern ISIS, or ISIL as I prefer because it's a better translation, the Taliban, others who believe that it's not just a matter of personal belief or religion, but this should control politics, this should control every other part of your life. The largest section of this, and the one that's most problematic, is called the Salafi movement. This is based upon the word Salaf, which means ancestor or predecessor. It is a desire by the followers of the Salafis, or Salafis as they're called, to go back and live their lives the way Muhammad and his immediate followers did. In the Quran, Muhammad is quoted as, or in the Hadith, excuse me, is quoted as saying, the people of my own generation are the best, and then those who come after them, and then the next generation. So the ideal of the Salafist movement is to get back to the way Muhammad and the first generations of his followers, the first 3 generations, how they lived. And that was a theocracy. The religion controlled the government, and that's what they're pushing for. The majority of the Salafists in the world are in Saudi Arabia, in Qatar, and in the United Arab Emirates. These are very conservative interpreters of Islam. Now, some people see this as synonymous with Wahhabism. Wahhabism is technically the primary religious belief in Saudi Arabia. Wahhabism was a reform movement. It started with a preacher and scholar named Muhammad ibn Abd al-Wahhab in the 1700s. Well, al-Wahhab joined together with the ancestors of Ibn Saud and others in the religious fervor and the political effort conquered most of Saudi Arabia. Then the Ottoman Empire came in and they suppressed them. Later on, when Ibn Saud came along in the 1920s, he joined forces again with the descendants of al-Wahhabi, so the Wahhabist religious movement, and the family political military power of Ibn Saud created modern Saudi Arabia. The Wahhabist movement is the most conservative of all of the movements. In fact, the theology of ISIL, or ISIS, is very much Wahhabist. And some people have said that, you know, there are a number of ordinary people in Saudi Arabia who would support this kind of thing, and that the goal of ISIL ultimately would be to come down and join with the people who agree with them in Saudi Arabia. Because not only would that give them an extended area of control and a lot more people on their side, but it also would give them a lot of oil fields. And so Wahhabism is the, and people don't realize, the most conservative, and to that extent, we could say oppressive. I mean, women in Saudi Arabia are not allowed to drive, they're not allowed to vote, they're, you know, they're very restricted. Because Arabia, and we don't talk about that because Arabia is our ally, right? Saudi Arabia. And because the House of Saud, those who rule there, really like their Western comforts and their wealth and their control and their link to the West. We're the ones that buy their oil, after all. They're not going to sell a lot of oil to Albania or wherever. And so they control that. And at various times they've had to suppress the Wahhabist inclinations of the common people. But that's always there. Okay? ISIL or ISIS. The difference in them, by the way, I recently was given a thing that said that Obama keeps calling it ISIL because that's an anti-Israel thing to say. That's horse hockey, all right? The reason that there's been a question about ISIS or ISIL, the original Arabic name of this organization is the Al-Dawa al-Islamiyya fi al-Iraq wa al-Shaab, or Daesh is what they call it locally. Well, al-Shaab, the first people in the West that started talking about that translated that as Syria. Al-Shaab does not mean Syria, it means the Levant. Levant is the whole area of the Middle East that includes Syria and Lebanon and Israel and part of Saudi Arabia. And so a better translation, once this could already be talked about, a lot of scholars said ISIS, the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, is not the right translation. It should be the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, ISIL. And so that's why there's been some difference there. They are very much, they're Wahhabist in their theology, they're Salafists, and that they want to go back to the original time, and, you know, that's the, they want to conquer these areas in the name of ultra-conservative Islam. It's important to know that every Islamic authority, the head of every Islamic state, every major Islamic religious leader, imams and muftis and everybody else, every one of them have declared ISIL to be a heretical, non-Islamic organization. Nobody else agrees with that. You cannot say that ISIL represents Islam in the world today. You simply can't, not if you know anything about what you're talking about. The fact is that the vast majority of people are not Wahhabists or Salafists. They're not part of ISIL or the Taliban. Those are extremes that do not represent the Islamic faith. I'm not Islamic, I'm not Muslim, I am Christian. But I'm going to be fair about this. When people paint all of Islam and all Muslims with that brush, it is not fair, it is not honest, it is not true. This afternoon, we have a class from 1 to 3, where it's called Apologetics 2, Response to the New Atheists. We're talking about the Richard Dawkinses and the Christopher Hitchenses and Daniel Dennett's and Sam Harris's, these guys. One of the things these guys do all the time is to say, you see how evil Christianity is? The Reverend Jim Jones in Guyana and David Koresh in Waco, and they quote all of these examples, and any Christian would go, wait a minute! That's not Christianity, not true Christianity, not what we believe Christianity is. Well, anybody who says that all Muslims are just like ISIL or just like Taliban are doing exactly the same thing. We don't like it when it gets done to us. And people will say, well, the Quran, you know, the Quran says it's okay to own slaves and it's okay to behead people, etc. Well, you know what? The Old Testament does too. And we don't take that as, you know, we believe that. I won't get into the theology of modern interpretation of the Old Testament because we still believe it's the Word of God. But we can't, again, we can't use that as the brush to paint them with because we, you know, we have the same concerns. Yes?
The only thing that comes to mind is that, you know, the Nazis were a very small, small part. Most people had nothing to do with. Most people just are peaceful. They want to live their lives, raise their families, you know, do well in the world. But it is the extremists. It is those ones that are willing to use violence and so forth that do take over.
Well,
because everybody else is peaceful and they just want to live their lives. And so what's frightening to me about this ISIL is to say, well, that doesn't represent all the Muslims. Well, of course it doesn't. Just as the Nazis were not, that was not all.
Okay, well, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. I'm not saying we shouldn't fight against them. I'm not saying they're okay.
But here's the difference to me is that people would stand up, I mean, Christians would say, it was wrong, these people in Guyana, wherever it was, they drank the Kool-Aid, this sort of thing. But I don't see Muslims standing up and saying, this is wrong.
Oh, absolutely they are. Okay. Absolutely they are.
I don't see
the
it.
Only reason they're not more vocal about that is because of the danger of backlash,
they're
because their own families might be threatened. Christians during the Nazi regime, not a lot of them, you know, it was very rare. There were a handful of people as the Confession Church who stood up and said, this is wrong. Why? Because of the, you know, Dietrich Bonhoeffer died in a concentration camp because he's one of the people who did that. And he had no family, or he probably wouldn't have. He postponed his wedding because he was afraid of the ramifications he might have. So, Muslims all over the world, like I told you, Muslim leaders who have less to fear because of their positions, they are absolutely adamant. This is not representative of Islam. And I'm not saying that these guys are okay. I'm not at all. We need to find ways to fight that. But don't say this represents Islam any more than David Koresh or Jim Jones represent Christianity.
But even the Saudi royalty, who have all the resources and the wealth in the world, they put up with that Wahhabi. I don't know if I say it right, but they put up with that secret police that go around and if a woman's ankle showing this much, get whipped. I mean, I don't understand how, with their resources, that they can put up.
Well, they have political reasons for doing that, but even the Saudis do not support ISIL. You know, the most extreme versions of that are not supported. And I've had people say, the Quran supports this, and all the Muslims really basically in their hearts agree with it. They absolutely don't. But they don't speak up more loudly because people get killed over speaking up about this. All right? If you thought that your children were going to get killed if you spoke up against some religious belief, would you be real quick to do it? It doesn't mean they agree with it. Yes?
A central tenet or doctrine of Christianity is our unity with God, that God is within us, and that we are the expression of the divine.
Actually, that is not true. That is not a Christian belief.
How does Islam look at this?
Well, when they are not, God is not within them. God made them. God is external. And by the way, this is the Christian belief too. The idea that that God is within us is not true. We are saved by God. God made us. He loves us. He saves us. That's Christianity. Islam doesn't have the lovey-dovey part, but it says that we are creations, that all of creation is a product of Allah, and He has a will for us, and we must be obedient to Him. Okay? The difference is that Christianity says that we are beneficiaries of the love and grace of God, and Islam would say, we've been given clear instructions, and you better follow those instructions. It's a much more regimented kind of thing. But both Islam and Christianity and Judaism make a very distinct separation between the Creator and the creation, whether it's us or the created world. It's not pantheism. God is not inside us. There is no divinity. And the Muslims and the Jews would say the same thing. You know, we have access to the love and grace of God, but you know, we are not God. He's not in us. This map gives you an idea. Again, some people think that ISIL has taken over all of the Syria and parts of the world. The black lines are the only areas that they absolutely control. The gray areas, the dark gray area, is the sections that they have freedom of movement in, but they don't actually have control there. They're still contested, but they can move pretty freely. And then the red parts are where there are major battles going on, like right outside Baghdad, you know, trying to take over Baghdad. But they're, you know, the Russians are there now, and one of the reasons why I just read an article about that this morning. One of the reasons that Putin has sent Russian military there and why they're bombing, they're not actually just bombing ISIL. They're also bombing the the rebels who are against the Syrian president, Assad, because Assad is one of the very few real allies that Russia has anymore. And so they're more concerned about preventing anybody from challenging Assad, including the same armies that are fighting against ISIL are part of the targets of the Russian bombing right now. Because they're not really concerned about ISIL. They're concerned about holding up Assad as long as they can, because Assad is one of the very few allies left in the world, and the Russian influence around the world is pretty much nil now, and Putin is trying to get that back. Yes, one more question.
Putin said that he was concerned about ISIL coming to Russia. Is that advantageous, in fact, in your opinion?
The question is, if Putin said that he was concerned about ISIL coming to Russia, well, a couple of them may get on a plane. You know, they're not so well organized as an army. In fact, they started out with this reputation of invincibility. They couldn't lose. Well, that was only when they were fighting against the Iraqi army, which was not well organized or well disciplined, even though they were well supplied. One of the reasons that ISIL has done so well is because when they defeated the Iraqi army and the Iraqis started running, they left behind U.S. armaments, tanks and, you know, howitzers and all that kind of stuff that ISIL took. Well, but in terms of, they are not a major military force. They're not going to march into Russia and be a threat to Russia. There's no way they could stand up against a geographically centralized major modern military. They are a guerrilla force, and they're very good at being a guerrilla force, but they're a guerrilla force. Yes?
I didn't think that they were army marching into Russia, but I was thinking of, I can't remember the name of the group that Russia was having a large problem with 10 years ago.
The Chechens?
Chechens.
Well, Chechens is a region.
I'm just wondering whether or not there's a support mechanism for their mentality.
I don't think you can justify that. I mean, I think it probably is a political statement. There's, when we say, well, they could fight Russia, well, Al-Qaeda was a small organization. In fact, ISIL came out of Al-Qaeda. And Al-Qaeda succeeded with the 9/11 attacks. So to the extent that they could have a major effect, yes, but not because they've got an army that's going to come in. Okay. Thank you all very much. I'm available for other questions. Sorry to go this long. It's a lot of material. I hope it's helpful. Blessings. I'll see you next week.